want to keep those on our prayer request list and remember them. Rick, he's going to have surgery this Tuesday to have a plate placed in his ankle that he broke when he had his accident. And he's pretty banged up. And Josie, who's on the scooter with him, she's at home. She broke her wrist. And Barb said that she had a lot of bruises, so she's needing our prayers for healing. And then Sally, she had family, or her kids give her a birthday party yesterday, which is very nice. Good to see some of the people that have known her for a long time there, and also for her kids. And her son, Terry, he lives in Asheville, North Carolina, and he was, they came out right after the storm hit, and he was saying that they still have no water. They've got power. Anyway, he's saying he can't work because he works in a restaurant, and no water, they can't do anything. But he says the area around Asheville is really just destroyed. So we want to keep all those folks in our prayers. And then Lucinda, she went home yesterday, and she's in hospice care. So just want to keep her and her family in our prayers. And then so those are our prayer request list. Dale, Gail, Duxbridge, Regina's uncle, Charles Moreland, Susan McAdams, and our shut-ins, Teresa, Rita, and Jean, and Sally. And then Paul's great niece, Zoe, is 12 years old. She's being diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. She lives in Kentucky, so we want to keep her and her family in our prayers. Let's go to Heavenly Father. Father, we give thanks to thee for all the many blessings. Father, you've given us all things, Lord. Father, we pray that you be with us this morning as we study your word. Father, we give thanks to you for this beautiful day to get us to come to worship you, Father. Father, I give thanks to you for all those that are here and those that are watching online, Father. Father, I pray that the things that we say this morning will help us better understand your will, Father, that we may be obedient to it. Father, I pray for all those on our prayer request list, Father, those have been mentioned that need your healing and power, Father. Father, be with thy will, restore health and strength to them. Be with their loved ones that are caring for them, Lord. And be with their medical people that are caring for them, Father, that they might provide the right treatments. Father, I pray that you be with us as we study your word and later on as we go into worship service. For Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, for those of you who have a workbook, we're on lesson 7. And that's on some page 27. Okay, we're in lesson 7 this morning. And that's in chapter 6 in 2 Corinthians. So I want to do just a brief review of where we're at, or some background information. The Corinthian church was started in AD 52 that Paul founded on his second missionary journey. And he writes it on his during his third missionary journey in the fall of AD 56. He had written 1 Corinthians in the spring of AD 56 to address problems of the Corinthian church. Paul wrote, like I say, he wrote it during his third missionary journey, and it's thought that he wrote it from Philippi, it's up here in Macedonia. The outline of 2 Corinthians is in three distinct divisions. One we're in, which I've highlighted, is Paul's explanation for not coming to visit the Corinthians, as he had promised, and an extended discussion of the Christian ministry And that's chapter 1 through chapter 7, verse 16. And then the second division is collection for the poor in chapters 8 and chapter 9, verse 16. And then the attack against the enemies of the cross, and it covers in chapter 10 through chapter 13. The main points from last week's lesson, which was chapter 5, Paul reminded the Corinthians of these truths. When Jesus returns, believers will receive a heavenly body from God. God has given believers the Holy Spirit as a guarantee of what is to come when Jesus returns. It is important to please God in every way, because every individual must appear before the judgment seat of Christ to receive the reward or punishment for what was done in the body. Paul's ministry is motivated by the following: knowing the terror, fear of the Lord, he consequently sought to persuade men Christ's love for us and that he died for all, his love for the Corinthians. Paul states those in Christ are a new creation initiated by God. Paul and his company are ambassadors for Christ, plan on behalf of Christ for the Corinthians to be reconciled to God. The theme of our chapter, of chapter 6, verses 1 through 10, began in at verse chapter 5, verse 11, which Paul shows his sincere devotion to his work as a gospel preacher. Chapter 6 may be divided into these sections: the apostle's self-vindication, that's verses 1 through 10, the appeal of the Corinthians to open their hearts to him, those are verses 11 through 13, and the exhortation not to have fellowship with unrighteousness, those verses 14 through chapter 7, verse 1. Okay, we're going to cover verses 6 or 1 through 10 in chapter 6. So I asked Evelyn if she could read this, these verses for us.
We then, as workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We give no offense in anything, that our ministry may not be blamed. But in all things we commend ourselves as ministers of God, in much patience, in tribulations and needs, in distresses and stripes, in imprisonments and torments, in labors and sleeplessness and fastings, by purity, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Spirit, by sincere love, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing all things.
Thank you.
I'm going to start in chapter 5, verse 20, because this is where the theme of this lesson starts, where it says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. We then, as workers together with you, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in acceptable time I've heard you, and in the day of salvation I've helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Textual difficulties here for a minute. Okay. Okay. here, I've highlighted, we then, as workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. And Paul's referring to the fact that the Corinthians had experienced the grace of God, and he describes this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, where it says, do you not know that the unrighteousness that will not inherit the kingdom of God, but do not be deceived, neither fornicators nor adulterers nor homosexuals nor sodomites, nor thieves nor covetous nor drunkards nor revilers nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So Paul reminded that they had received the grace of God. This is from our work, the commentator on our workbook. His basis of appeal for them to adhere to the grace of God is a reminder that they are the recipients of blessings that previous generations could only anticipate. And this is, we find this in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12, which reads, of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ, the glories that would follow. To them it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit, sent from heaven, things which angels desire to look into. Verse 2, which is a quote from Isaiah chapter 41, verse 8, which reads, for it says, in acceptable time I've heard you, and the day of salvation I've helped you. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And looking at Isaiah 49, verse 8, I've highlighted that the part that refers to that quote from Paul. Thus says the Lord, in acceptable time I've heard you, in the day of salvation I've helped you. This is from a commentary by Willis, Truth Commentary. Because Christ has already come and has made atonement for sins according to God's eternal purpose, this special moment of time has arrived. Isaiah's words have been fulfilled. For this reason, the apostles, as God's co-workers and Christ's ambassadors, are busily engaged in the ministry of reconciliation by preaching the word of reconciliation before this time of reconciliation passes away. In Acts 17, verse 30-31, Paul refers to this again. He says, truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. Looking at verse 3, we give no offense to anything that our ministry may not be blamed. Here, I refer to the commentator again. The apostle is painfully aware that the charges of misconduct have been maliciously leveled against him. Some say that he has changed his travel plans in his own selfish interest, that he has been dishonest in the way he has handled money received from churches, that he possesses inadequate verbal skills, and that he constantly suffers hardships because of God's disfavor. Therefore, he deserves both negatively and positively his determination not to do anything that will cause anyone to stumble. His real concern is that in some way the ministry service itself will get a bad name because of any slight or offense on his part, but far more likely because of slanderous criticism that some of the Corinthians have come to believe about him. In another commentary, Holman commentary describes this, the purpose of Paul's care was that his ministry might not be discredited. Paul knew that many people will will distrust the truth, even the truth of the gospel that ministers life, does not conform to the to that truth. Christian ministry is not just a matter of speaking the truth. It also consists of living the truth. Paul is careful not to live hypocritically. See, this is a table of the, it's also in our workbook, of the of hardships and that Paul experienced, and also the internal qualities that he describes in verses 4 through 10, which we'll be covering. Okay, patience was one of those virtues that was listed. Patience serves both as a trait of character and as an introductory title to the following list of adversities. Patience itself is a virtue rather than hardship, therefore it balances two halves of the group. The effect of his position at the head of the list is to encase Paul's sufferings in a catalog of virtues. The virtues therefore serve to indicate the manner and means by which Paul deals with his hardships and persecutions. In another commentary, these hardships that Paul experiences are described in this manner. First, he mentioned general difficulties, troubles, hardships, and distresses. Then the apostle listed three specific kinds of persecution he endured in his ministry: beatings, imprisonments, and riots. He experienced all three of these in Philippi. Third group describes the impositions he accepted as part of the demands of ministry. He was not averse to hard work, nor a stranger to sleepless nights, nor to hunger. Paul balances nine kinds of trials in three triads with nine internal qualities. The first here are given in four couplets. Purity referred to practical righteousness, and understanding was a practical knowledge that which displayed sensitivity in dealing with others. Patience is the ability to bear up under the oversights and wrongs afflicted by others without retaliating, and kindness is love in action. And the Holy Spirit may be a metronome, I can't pronounce that, a figure of speech in which the cause stands for effects. If so, then the Holy Spirit represents which he causes, namely the spiritual fruit, or control by the Spirit. Or possibly the phrase should be translated in the spirit of holiness to describe dedicated attitude. He hoped his sincere love would be evident to his readers and would invoke in them a similar response. In truthful speech, you proclaim the gospel and rely on the power of God and the person's spirit to produce results. And I've cited the commentary that I got that from. Relying on God, Paul is completely equipped with weapons or armor of righteousness to cope with the attacks of the adversary from any quarter, right or left, and send him fleeing. And Paul refers to his armor of God and also or describes it in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. His next group occurs in Paris, contrasting the evaluation of his work by God or his friends with that of his enemies. And this is verses 8 through 10, verses by honor and dishonor, evil report and good report, as deceivers, yet true, unknown, yet well known, as dying, we live, as chastened, yet not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing all things. So highlight those the pairs that we're talking about. Okay, look in verse 8. By honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers yet true, as unknown yet well known. And Paul was spoke of the conflicting responses to his ministry, and then and these verses here were. Some of the Corinthians honored him, others that the false teachers, or the ones influenced by false teachers, were saying that, looked at him with dishonor, and then also are saying evil things about him. And here, these verses are the ones I've highlighted, these prayers I've highlighted. Dying, we live. Chastened, not killed. Sorrowful, rejoicing. And this is where Paul is describing his own responses to these criticisms. And then here, verse 10, sorrowful as poor, yet making me rich, having nothing, yet possessing all things. Here's Paul describing the results of his ministry. Okay, these were things that Paul endured and experienced so that the ministry would not be blamed and he would not cause anyone to stumble. So before we move on to the next section, are there any questions or comments? Okay, I'm going to ask Evelyn to read again. Look at verses 11 through 13.
Oh, Corinthians, we have spoken openly to you. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections. Now, in return for the same, I speak as to you children. You also be open.
Here Paul is just simply saying he had not held back his emotions but had spoken openly to them. He asked for the same from them. He had made a space in his heart for them. Ye are not straitened in us. And has asked that they do the same for them. He is speaking to them as a father does to his children. Okay. We're going to look at verses 14 through chapter 7, verse 1. So, okay. Laura, you want to read this for us?
Okay. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God.
Okay, looking at verse 14, it says, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. We'll look at that. Here he's saying this exhortation is this, be not equally yoked with unbelievers. Unequally yoked reminds us of the Old Testament prohibition of plowing with an oak yoke to an ass. That's in Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 10. It discusses those associations and fellowships in which one is joined to those who are not obeying the Lord. And then looking at the rest of that, where I've highlighted here in verse 14 and 15, 16. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Baal? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? So Paul is supporting his admonition to separate by asking rhetorical questions to which he expected the response to be nothing. And here, put this in a table. These questions, fellowship, righteousness, unrighteousness, communion, light, darkness, concord or agreement, Christ, Baal, part, believer, infidel, agreement, temple of God, idols. Looking at the rest of verse 16, for you are a temple of the living God, as God has said, will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they will, shall be my people. So Paul reminds the individual Christian that he is a temple of God. The Most High God does not dwell in temples made with hands, but in the hearts of living beings who love and adore him. Paul exhorts them to separate themselves from wickedness and the wicked by reminding them of God's promise of association, fellowship with them, using quotations from the Old Testament to make his appeal. And one quotation comes from Leviticus chapter 26, verse 12. Says, "I will walk among you and be your God, and you shall be my people." And for us today, this applies in Matthew 18, verse 20. It says, "For where two or three are gathered together by name, I am in the midst of them." This is Jesus speaking to his disciples. In 2 Corinthians, in verse 17, read, "Therefore, come out from among them, be separate, says the Lord. Do not judge what is unclean, and I'll receive you." Here, Paul's referring to Isaiah 52, verse 11. It says, or reads, "Depart, go out from there, touch no unclean thing. Go out from the midst of her, be clean, you who bear the vessels of the Lord." And this is where Paul, or Isaiah, is referring to the time when the Israelites will depart from Babylon and go back to Jerusalem. And then in Ezekiel, "I'll bring you out from the peoples and gather you out of the countries where you are scattered with a mighty hand, with an outstretched arm of fury poured out." So this is, again, referring to Israel's redemption, but it also applies to, Paul's applying it to the Corinthians. So Paul was not encouraging isolation from unbelievers, as read in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14 through 16, where it says, "Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain." So Paul's discouraging compromise with their sinful values and practices. He was urging them and us to maintain integrity in the word, just as Christ did. Verse 18 says, "I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty." And here Paul is saying this is God's promise, a special relationship with faithful believers, similar to God's relationship with David, which we read about in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 14. "I'll be his father, and he shall be my son." And then I've highlighted that part of the verse. And then in Isaiah 43, verse 6, which is the rest of that quote that Paul uses. It says, "I'll say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the ends of the earth." Looking at chapter 7, verse 1, "Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God." So Paul concludes by appealing on the basis of these promises that he refers to in verses 17, 18, for the Corinthians to cleanse themselves from every defilement of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness and fear of God. Okay, so the summary, Paul continues to appeal to the Corinthians who have been influenced by the false teachers and the worldly culture of Corinth to be reconciled back to God. Paul describes the hardships he endured so that his ministry would not be blamed and not cause anyone to stumble. And then Paul tells the Corinthians he has opened his heart to them and expects them to do the same. that Paul exhorts the Corinthians to separate themselves from an unbelieving world in order to have a father, son, and daughter relationship with God. Okay, so discussion questions. How is the influence of an unbelieving world dangerous to Christians? Yeah, Bill. Because apparently, the fact that Paul is writing this letter indicates how strong the influence was of these false teachers, that they had caused some of the Corinthians to question him as an apostle, and question what he was preaching. So, okay. What can Christians do to not be influenced by an unbelieving world?
Stay close to the Word of God and stay close to Jesus as much as you can.
Amen. Your thoughts?
There's everything out there. There's movies, there's holidays, there's games. There's just constant bombardment of everything, advertisement, clothes. You pick and choose just by anything you want.
You're a smartphone.
I said a smartphone.
Oh, yeah, I've got a smartphone. So there's a lot of things that are around. Yeah, Gerald.
What we see throughout the New Testament is the influence from either Jewish religion or pagan religions. We look and we see atheism as the great threat to Christianity, and it's not. It's the false teachings of all the other religions that can find their way in. So the unbelieving world is not defined by those who are atheists, but by those who do not follow the truth of God. And that is the greatest threat to the church, is adopting those things.
Good point.
That's kind of what I was thinking.
Yeah.
The world is those that claim to be Christians but aren't following His word.
Yeah. Which is what the false teachers are doing. To follow. Yeah.
They believe their God, but they didn't believe in the way He was teaching it.
It's like cherry pick.
Words like gay. Gay used to mean happy. That means homosexual. Compromising. Oh, it was. Say they're going to hell, or the church is softening on things like that, and we can't.
Good point. It's all true.
Like what Paul was doing with the Corinthians. Any other thoughts? Okay. Another thought that I have was be that fact of what we're doing here right now. You know, we're studying God's word and fellowship with one another. And if we don't fellowship, we don't study, then the things that the world is doing will influence us or have greater influence of us. So we have to counteract that. And because it's been my experience, working with Christians that are having problems, struggling with life, with addictions and so forth, drinking or whatever, that what happens a lot of times is they, especially if they're new Christians, is that they stop fellowshipping with the church, and they get pulled back to with their friends, and so then they end up going back to their addictions, and that's been one experience I've had. Yeah, Bill.
Yeah, with that, I was just reading about, TV evangelism is good, but some people substitute fellowship for TV evangelism, and they miss out on what you're saying. They don't get that, but God said exhort one another, encourage one another, forsake not the assembling themselves one another. They just eliminate that and think, well, they're serving Jesus by watching the TV, and they miss out on what you're saying, and that they drift back into the, devil's.
That's a good point, too. Two Churches of Christ that broadcast here locally, and at the end, both of them encourage you to go to church, and they list Churches of Christ you can visit. And right after that, another thing comes on where an individual tells you to light a candle. They never encourage you to come to church. It's all done from home, which is a false teaching.
It is.
Then they put that envelope thing up in. If you want to donate money to this address,
yeah.
Thank you for joining us this Sunday.
Paul spent 18 months at Corinth teaching and preaching to them, yet they still were influenced by unbelievers. What is the lesson for us today? Any thoughts there? Yep, John.
Some momentum, you got it going, and then you ease up, and you slow down, and you lose your momentum.
So, let's continue doing, saying God's word, fellowship
one another, exhorting one another, encouraging one another. Okay. We're about out of time, so next week's lesson will be chapter 7, Good News from Corinth, and Wally will be presenting that lesson to us. All right, thank you for your good comments.
Thank you.
Okay. So we're dismissed until 10:30.